Yes.
Hi there. Good evening, everyone. Today we are going to be speaking about building resiliency during periods right now when we are feeling stressed and anxious. Thank you so much again for joining in on this webinar. I will admit something. This is only the second time I've honestly done a Zoom webinar. So hopefully this is my second one and things go a little bit smoother than they did earlier this morning. Apparently, a lot of people just saw my face rather than my PowerPoint. So that was just kind of a, oh well. It is what it is. My name's Jenny Lee Almeida. I'm the mental health educator at CMHA. And yeah, so we wanted to create some webinars just to kind of talk about what we're feeling, what we're experiencing right now. So if my presentation helps. Okay, so what you're seeing is just kind of something that we do talk a lot about, and that's resiliency, right? Our ability to recover from or adjust easily to misfortune or change. And right now, that's needless to say that we are experiencing a lot of change, a lot of adjustment. Our world has flipped, right? So we're adjusting with that. So a lot of the feelings that we're experiencing, how do we cope with this change? And I have these three flowers, and I wish all change could be so beautiful like that. But we know sometimes with change comes a lot of our responses. And, right at the beginning, and I remember this date where it was March 13th or 14th, I happened to be at home sick with a cold. And I had been isolating for a while already because of my colds. And right away, I remember on the 13th or 14th, it was just that utter shock and disorientation. You know, is this really happening? Like, no. And, I'll be honest, I haven't not felt or experienced any emotions related to anger. But, again, we're also humanly different. And that's probably amazing with us humans that how we respond, emotionally, it's going to vary from person to person. While someone might experience anger, another person might experience a lot of feelings related to that anxiety, feeling doom and gloom, fear, just feeling really scared of what's going on. And I think everybody is now, this has been, 1 week where we've been living day to day of this new normal. And so we're coming to learn how we are currently dealing with this new situation, our new way of living in this moment, right? And lastly, acceptance and moving forward. So, what is a stress response? How do we what happens, right? We know that our stress response, it's an adaptive response. We experience our fight, our flight, or a freeze response. It is a response that is internal that allows us to understand what is happening around us so we can adapt to circumstances. We can respond accordingly, and if we don't, we're learning, right? So within our fight, flight, freeze response and the stress response, what starts it, what triggers it is really is that alarm, right? And then after we are resistant, and then we go into repair. We do know there's that increased blood pressure, heart rate, but generally when people ask about stress, is that a good or bad thing? We generally like to say, no, stress is bad. And we hear this all the time, right? Too much stress, compacted stress, complex traumatic stress built up, not good. But then I started to see this video, and I am going to share this clip with you. Hopefully, it's not going to be choppy for connections, so please be patient with me as I try to move from screen to screen. Can stress be our friend? So Kelly McGonigal, really, that became her life's work. She was a health psychologist, and her whole life she spent pretty much counseling individuals that stress is not your friend. Watch out, right? We have to carry less stress. And now she's changed her whole way of thinking, and she's actually asserting that now, with the science and the technology, we're able to really understand how does stress, the stress response, affect our heart, our cardiovascular, and how does it gear up for that alarm? So I'm going to show you this. So I'm going to see what I can do. I'm going to pause my share for 1 second, and I am going to, fingers crossed, that I am able to get this really good. And if I do, that's pretty awesome, because did not do it so good this morning. Okay, so I'm going to resume share. Hopefully what you're seeing is YouTube video. It is actually a TEDx. Isn't amazing? It's 14 minutes. I'm not going to speak. I'm not going to talk about the whole thing, but I'd really like to, listen to a little bit and hear what she has to say. So fingers crossed this works.
Telling people stress is bad for your health. So this study got me wondering, can changing how you think about stress make you healthier? And here the science says yes. When you change your mind about stress, you can change your body's response to stress. Now, to explain how this works, I want you all to pretend that you are participants in a study designed to stress you out. It's called the social stress test. You come into the laboratory and you're told you have to give a 5-minute impromptu speech on your personal weaknesses to a panel of expert evaluators sitting right in front of you. And to make sure you feel the pressure, there are bright lights and a camera in your face, kind of like this. And the evaluators have been trained to give you discouraging nonverbal feedback, like this. Now that you're sufficiently demoralized, time for part two, a math test. And unbeknownst to you, the experimenter has been trained to harass you during it. Now, we're going to all do this together. It's going to be fun for me. Okay. I want you all to count backwards from 996 in increments of 7. You're going to do this out loud as fast as you can, starting with 996. Go. Go faster. Faster, please. You're going too slow. Stop, 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 stop. That guy made a mistake. We're going to have to start all over again. You're not very good at this, are you? Okay, so you get the idea. Now, if you were actually in this study, you'd probably be a little stressed out. Your heart might be pounding, you might be breathing faster, maybe breaking out into a sweat. And normally, we interpret these physical changes as anxiety or signs that we aren't coping very well with the pressure. But what if you viewed them instead as signs that your body was energized, was preparing you to meet this challenge? Now, that is exactly what participants were told in a study conducted at Harvard University. Before they went through the social stress test, they were taught to rethink their stress response as helpful. That pounding heart is preparing you for action. If you're breathing faster, it's no problem. It's getting more oxygen to your brain. And participants who learned to view the stress response as helpful for their performance, well, they were less stressed out, less anxious, more confident. But the most fascinating finding to me was how their physical stress response changed. Now, in a typical stress response, your heart rate goes up, and your blood vessels constrict like this. And this is one of the reasons that chronic stress is sometimes associated with cardiovascular disease. It's not really healthy to be in this state all the time. But in the study, when participants viewed their stress response as helpful, their blood vessels stayed relaxed like this. Their heart was still pounding, but this is a much healthier cardiovascular profile. It actually looks a lot like what happens in moments of joy and courage. Over a lifetime of stressful experiences, this one biological change could be the difference between a stress-induced heart attack at age 50 and living well into your 90s.
Okay. I apologize. I did not show you the entirety of that TEDx talk. It is phenomenal. And if you'd like to search that, I will send some links on Monday with all those resources. But it is Kelly McGonigal, How to Make Stress Your Friend. And you don't even need to remember her name, although she's pretty memorable in terms of all their TEDx talks. So I encourage you, How to Make Stress Your Friend. So, you know, that helps when we are viewing stress as our friend. And what really stuck with me is, you know, our cardiovascular, us mimicking what it looks like in moments of joy and courage. And I've been hearing that word a lot, you know, courage, in terms of what we're doing. And, you know, just by changing our perception and how we're viewing our stress could be extremely helpful for us all in managing and, you know, riding these waves of uncertainty, right, in regards to COVID-19. So what is signaling, right? So really quickly, this is our fight, flight, freeze response. Typically signaling occurs when right away your brain, you are seeing something, right? Something is alerting you that there is danger. So our sensory perception, internal signals, brain registers, and there you go. So that is what it looks like going on. But we don't see it that way, do we? How does stress get our attention? Well, stress finally starts to get our attention when our body presents it. Bill, a good quote from Alice Miller. And what that means is, you know, when you are experiencing stress, and I can definitely, you know, indicate that I believe we all collectively have experienced a lot of stress, anxiety, fear, panic, you know, just simply being afraid of what's going on right now. How has it hurt? How do we know we're feeling this? Where do we hold it on our body? You know, where do you feel it? And I always tell in all of my presentations I do, I find it so extremely helpful. You know, when people ask me what's the best thing, you know, I can do to minimize stress, reduce anxiety. You know, sometimes it's as easy as get to know yourself, get to know, where does it hurt? How does stress alert you that you're not doing good? Where does it tell you in your body? I usually like to say, you know, mentally, emotionally, physically, where are you noticing it? The more insight and knowledge you can get from yourself, because you are the world's expert, you have more insight into, so I can attach some strategies to, you know, help reduce that feeling or help reduce that physical sensation that I don't like. So get to know yourself. And I think right now the negative effects of stress, and I can even replace that with the negative effects of, you know, us all experiencing, you know, this pandemic. Without a doubt, I'm presuming that a lot of stress has caused or exacerbated symptoms related to depression, to anxiety, pain of any kind, right? That's number one in terms of pain, chronic pain, and our sleep. We start to feel it right away, those effects of stress. And the list goes on and on, right? So we know that it affects us. So what can we do, right? Another big thing, another question I always constantly ask is, you know, what's the difference? What is the difference between anxiety and stress? And, you know, here's the difference. Stress and anxiety are often used interchangeably. So if you're feeling stressed, right, stress is you have a stressor, right? You know what that stressor is. What you start feeling in terms of rapid heart rate or racing thoughts, worrying thoughts, feeling fear about the future, uncertainty, those might be interchangeably in symptoms related to anxiety. Anxiety is also that focus, that response. It is our internal response as well. So stress focuses mainly on external pressures, on what, on us, things that we're finding hard to cope with. And symptoms of stress typically, almost always, disappear after the situation or the stressor is removed. Whereas anxiety, I always say, you know, anxiety focuses on worries, fears. Think about it, what you fear for in the future, fear in the past, things that threaten us, right? Or it could be about anxiety itself, which is very common, not liking the feeling of anxiety and worrying and all the physiological things that are happening, right? We start to then increase anxieties about feeling, oh no, I don't want to increase that anxiety. So anxiety, like I said, it's our body's reaction to perceived danger, important events, right? It alerts us to danger and it helps our body deal with it. It prepares us to deal with it. So anxiety is defined by persistent, excessive worrying, a lot of worries that might not even, that don't go away, even if I remove all those stressors, right? So again, anxiety can lead to very identical set of symptoms as stress producing. So what is the big difference? When we categorize anxiety disorders, it differs from short-term feelings of anxiety. That feeling of anxiety, short-term, when it's attached to stress, it's not extreme in its intensity or in severity, because it doesn't last long. We start to adapt. We start to find that new normal. But when it starts to persist for months, and you are starting to know like something is different, it starts to negatively impact your mood, your functioning. You know, and that functioning piece is very important, right? And, you know, if that sleep is getting drastically affected, right? Functioning in terms of not being able to focus 100% on work. And here, just a side note, you know, right now it is absolutely okay not to be feeling like I'm able to focus wholeheartedly on my work, right? It's okay. There's a pandemic going on. It is absolutely normal for us to all be experiencing increased stress, worries. And why are we worried? Why are we feeling this? Well, because a lot of this is thinking into the future. What's going to happen tomorrow? What's going to happen the next day? And what we're knowing is it seems to be changing day in, day out, right? So I think a good lesson for us all is just to try our best not to get ahead of us ourselves when we start thinking, you know, oh my gosh, you know, what's it going to be like on Monday? You know, what else is going to happen? And changing or shifting our perspective or our, you know, our perception of, okay, you know, I can't control that right now. So I can just focus on what I am in control of. So again, you see a really quick slide of what anxiety is. And again, sometimes with anxiety, there's not going to be a danger, but our body, our brain, our physiological cascade, it's all happening, but there's no perceived danger, right? So sometimes I usually like to say anxiety is an emotional, it's a psychological, physiological reaction, and it's happening all at once, and the focus really is internal, right? Internal meaning it's not something that this is why I'm feeling anxious, this is why I'm experiencing this and this, right? Sometimes it has no stressor, okay? So how are we able to manage that stress and anxiety during what's happening right now? So as I mentioned, it's absolutely normal to feel stress. I just smiled quickly because I looked some stress, and I should have put, it's normal to feel a lot of stress right now because we're all experiencing stress and anxiety. I'd really strongly encourage, don't try to avoid, ignore, suppress those feelings. Instead, acknowledge them, be aware of them. Again, be your world's, you are the world's expert. Get to know yourself and name your feelings, name those emotions. It's okay to say, you know, this sucks. I don't like feeling anxious, and that's how I'm feeling right now. So we try to keep things in perspective. Notice, challenge those thoughts that may be extreme or unhelpful. You know, nobody's perfect. We all are, I think, all together in this. We're all experiencing a lot more stress and anxiety than we, you know, some normally. This is something we're all in this together, right? So I'm going to be honest. And last week, it was probably a Monday. I don't remember. Days start to blend into each other. As you can tell, I'm working from home. So I was really stressed. I'm not a teacher. And all I kept thinking was, how am I going to teach my 8-year-old everything? And I was stressing and worrying and increasing my anxiety on trying to control, you know, having a schedule and what that's going to look like and blocking time and how am I going to work from home at the same time. And then I took a deep breath and I just kept things in perspective, and I thought, probably not going to do good at being that teacher, but I'm a pretty good mom, so it's all right if she's learning how to do laundry right now, or learning more about what I do, or how to, you know, cook macaroni and cheese, you know, things like that. So it's really challenging yourself when you are getting into, I always say that vicious cycle, when one worrying thought leads to another, and the next thing you know, you've spiraled, and the anxiety is really up, and you just feel like, oh no, help me, how do I get back out, right? And a good way to get back out is taking that deep breath, right? Taking deep breath in, managing what you can, releasing what you cannot. And that is absolutely realistic right now and what we're all collectively experiencing. So building that resilience, right? When we're experiencing this unprecedented time right now, we have to remember that it's absolutely imperative that we lean on each other. Even if we can't be close physically, we honestly need to remain close emotionally. Another good point is self-care is utterly and extremely important right now, because like I just mentioned, our worries have increased, our stress has increased, our anxiety has increased, which therein probably has, you know, changed your routine, changed your sleep patterns, changed your activity patterns, changed your eating patterns, whatever. We're noticing our bodies, our brains, they're starting to present its bill to us saying, this is hard. So it's important that we really spend more time leaning in on our social supports, trying to stick to a routine, a semblance of a routine that, you know, you had prior to all of this starting in regards to our pandemic. So, you know, do things that are meaningful to you. And nobody knows what that is except for yourself. So do the things you would typically do to support your health. And be sure to caution and follow that health and safety guidelines while doing that. And again, all about perspective and perceptions, right? It's really important that, you know, oh, my quote didn't turn out great. I apologize. So when life gives you 100 reasons to break down and cry, you show life that you have 1,000,000 reasons to smile and laugh. And it's just flipping that script And, you know, we practice, we learn by practicing. And the more we practice, the more it sticks with us, right? So every time you have a stressful worry, a worrying thought, an unhelpful thought, or you find you're going in that vicious cycle of unhelpful thinking that's increasing that stress and anxiety, just catch that emotion, validate that that's what you're feeling, and it's not going to stay permanent. And you can take a deep breath in, you take a deep breath out, and you say, I can get through this, right? Okay, so what else are we able to do? So right now, I apologize. Oh no. Okay, so I'm gonna try to see if I can go back to my slide. But if I can't, not a big deal. Oh, yes, I can. Okay, so what can we do? A warm meal, kind words, right? Listen, we have all the time in the world right now to pick up that phone, and we need to remain socially connected, right? So listen to yourself when your body, your mind, your heart are telling you stuff. Listen to others and, you know, help others, call in, check in on people. You know, fascinating thing that makes us feel better is helping others actually helps us. When you help someone else, when you're checking in on someone, asking them, you know, how are you doing? How's your stress level? Are you feeling okay? I just want to check in on you. It's actually helping you, and it makes us feel good. You know, sometimes what a big thing right now is, there's a lot of stress around finances, our economy, what is going on, work, not working. You know, it's everything is changing. And, you know, when I start thinking of that cascade, it's write it down and think, okay, I'm finding myself worrying a lot about stress finances. So commit to writing it down and making a plan. Whether it's discussing finances with a partner, you know, a family unit, it doesn't matter. You know, we feel less anxious and less stressed. I'm just going to say just little. when we plan things out, right? When we have, okay, I could do this, I could do this, or I could do this. Because what that does is that builds our resiliency, because we're trying, right? We're trying to rise up to this challenge. We're trying to problem solve. And sometimes that really does help us feel like we have a little bit more of a control. Humans, right? We need to feel and be connected, the doubt. So maintaining our social connection is crucial right now. Again, FaceTime, utilize videos, be creative, right? For teenagers, for adults, for absolutely anybody who loves video games, you know, and I think now's your time where you can really, you know, strike up a conversation, play with your friends, a video game, you know, watch a movie together. I think it's called Netflix Party. I don't know. There's a lot of new technology out there. Hence, I'm using Zoom for the first time, right? And resources, map out important resources ranging from daily necessities, emergency, everything is important that way. Get to know what are those trusted resources, what are those trusted sites you want to get to. Okay, so lighten the load intellectually. Here's the thing, don't overdo it. On days when, you know, you don't have that energy, it's okay to not feel okay. A lot is going on in the world around us, you know, and it's okay, you know. If you don't have the energy, you might try again the next day, right? Let others know around you that maybe you need extra space. If you're in, you know, if you're living with a lot of individuals, but if you're living right now all alone or isolate or having to isolate or you're in quarantine, you know, maybe you have your pet, maybe a pet that's you want to tell them. Regardless, it's letting others know where you're at And it's okay to tell someone, I need space or I'm feeling stressed, and talking it out, right? You can take a fun course online, that too. One of the fun, really fun course, actually the most popular course ever offered by Harvard. I posted on our Facebook account. It is free. And that is the happiness course. And that is running through Harvard right now for free. So check out Facebook. Self-talk, how you are speaking to yourself, very important. So when you start to notice yourself, you know, getting lost in thought about the future or the past, you know, bring yourself back to the present, taking a deep breath in and getting, you know, acknowledging what you're experiencing, taking a deep breath and utilizing those strategies and tools you have in your toolbox. So what are some basic tips? So again, we want to ensure that we're taking care of our body, you know, our sleep, our eat, activity, very important, our exercise, how much, get our body moving. You know, if you have mobility issues, if, you know, you live in an apartment unit, it does not matter. You could do simple activities by just sitting in a chair, you know, raising your arms up, grabbing some little weights. And if you don't have weights, just grab, you know, two cans. It does not matter. It's any type of movement. Our bodies crave movement. We love it. So changing that, and it really does. Active exercise or participation, any activity, you know, 20 to 30 minutes a day, it really does elevate our mood. It reduces that stress level we feel. It improves sleep. And right now, you know, a lot of you might be feeling, you know, like myself, where my sleep has definitely been impacted. A nice picture I just pulled. I saw it a couple days ago and I really liked it. And it was grounding tips for changing times. I really liked just the simplicity of it, right? In terms of that perspective, that gratitude, practicing positive affirmations, practicing gratitude every day really just helps us. Writing things down, moving mindfully. And let's talk about our intake of social media. That is one thing that we can definitely do to reduce that stress that we might be experiencing right now. I'll be wholeheartedly honest, with everything that started, I believe on the 13th, 14th, and then the 16th, my sleep was off and I would be waking up all hours of the night. And the first thing I do is grab my phone and I start looking, okay, what's going on in the world? What other news things have they released? And it just wasn't working. You know, going to bed right before you go to bed and scrolling through Twitter or Instagram or Facebook, and, you know, our brains cannot handle that much information and it's processing all at once. And right now, I know with everything going on, you know, it's a lot of overwhelmingly stressful things that, you know, we're listening to, we're hearing, we're reading, we're visually seeing pictures of. And I would really encourage to, you know, don't do it before bed. Lesson learned for myself. But, you know, cut back, yeah, hide some individuals, you know, mute people that you might follow right now if you're noticing that, oh, these posts are really, you know, they stress me out, or I feel really sad when I'm hearing, I'm seeing this. You know, we need to take those social media breaks because we can't be on there 24 hours. A sense of humor, you know, it's hard to think of anything humorous right now. But a sense of humor can really be an amazing line of defense when it comes to coping with stress. You know, so I've been trying to watch something funny, or, you know, look at a funny meme with my daughter, just things that will make me more mindfully aware of laughter and how it really does heal and reduce symptoms related to anxiety and stress. It really is a fabulous thing to use. So, you know, I tried looking for a lot of videos to show you all so I can make everyone laugh. But, you know, it's hard to find a PG-rated video, I'll be honest. But Google Ellen, YouTube Ellen, you know, maybe watch America's Funniest Videos with your children if you have children. You know, be creative, right? But don't forget to laugh, really important. So again, call your feelings out for what they are. If we focus too much on what's stressing us out, we're not able to process it because we don't have control over what's going on in the world right now in terms of that pandemic, in terms of COVID-19 and worrying about everything around us. But when we're able to, you know, say, okay, that is, you know, I'm feeling heartache, I'm feeling fear because of this, and just calling someone and saying, I need to work through this. That's how we're able to understand and process it and, you know, take those strategies. And that's how we become more attuned to how we are responding to stress and anxiety. Don't stress about stressing out, right? It's not going to do any good. I forget the quote. It's a really good quote from someone where, you know, I spent 99% of my life worrying about things that didn't even happen. And I mean, we can't continue to stress out because we have to take it one day at a time right now. So, you know, every night just taking a deep breath, going to bed and, you know, okay, tomorrow's a new day. And I don't know what is going to be on the news. I don't know. But I'm able to, you know, talk myself through those feelings and process it and speak to someone. So focusing on what we value instead of what we fear right now, right? We can focus a lot of our time, our efforts on things that make us feel better, make us feel safe, instead of focusing on the fear. Because when we focus on that fear, it's unknown, and we don't have a solution for what's going on right now around us. I apologize. You can't see my word. So my last word is, you know, don't expect stability. It's quite all right. You know, you're not going to get everything on that grocery list. You're not going to, you know, feel like you're 100% productive at work. If you're working remotely, if you're in the office, this is an unprecedented time we are currently all living in. So please don't expect that stability. You know, we have to be realistic and take each day at a time right now. Another great strategy that is good to help reduce those feelings, symptoms related to stress, anxiety, is really incorporating mindfulness into your day. And mindfulness really just means maintaining a moment-to-moment awareness of your thoughts, your feelings, bodily sensations, your surrounding environment, non-judgmentally. Right? So it's just kind of naming it and being aware of it. So I will show you one more. So here we go. So let's say we all take a moment to notice our breath as it is in this moment. Okay. So whether you're taking a deep breath in right now, if you're holding that breath, mindfulness practices is to focus in on the attention to the present moment. So focusing in on your breath. What are you aware of right now? Noticing what is happening within yourself, around you, others. And, you know, it helps liberate us from those distressing thoughts and feelings. And it allows us to feel calmer, think more clearly, and to make good decisions, but also to help us during the midst of the stress and a lot of fear and uncertainty that we're experiencing right now. Another great tool that I love is connecting to the present with my five senses. So this was kind of an introductory to mindfulness to me. I found that when I was able to use my self-soothe, my five senses, I noticed a lot. Okay, I'm mindfully present. I'm right here. And that helped. And it was something that I was able to do with my daughter. Perfect coloring, right? What are we doing? We're coloring. What color do you see? Are you hearing anything? Might have music in the background, you know, feeling that pencil in your hand, right? So that's a great thing that we can do. One of my favorite, my introduction to mindfulness was a really great strategy. It's called Take Five. Absolutely love it. I think that's the next slide. So here's hoping it is. If not, it's okay. I will get there. Oh, it wasn't. My bad. Okay. So just a little quote, right? You should sit in meditation for 20 minutes every day. Unless you're too busy, then you should sit for an hour. And that is just to acknowledge that the more time we are feeling too busy or too stressed, is that more time that we actually need to devote to our self-care, right? So whether we're, you know, and mindfulness, you can meditate and practice mindfulness strategies just by coloring, painting, doing a puzzle, listening to music. It could be anything, knitting, crocheting, simply sitting, listening to music and taking deep breaths in and out, feeling that breath.
Hey everyone, Corey Mascara here.
Okay, so here is my video. I'm gonna back up, and this is my favorite video. It's called Take Five. I really hope you like it because this was my introduction to mindfulness, and I do it all the time, and teach it to a lot of young kids, youth. Honestly, if you like it, try it and show others. You can find this video, Take Five. That's what you would YouTube or search. Hopefully you can hear him.
Corey Mascara here. People are always asking me for, you know, what is a simple strategy that I can utilize throughout the day, you know, in addition to my formal meditation practice, just to reground myself, recenter myself. And one thing I learned recently that I've found people seem to love is this strategy called Take Five, which you can do if you only have 30 seconds. So I just want to share it with you here. It's really simple. I say we do it together. Take out your left hand and just place it in front of you like this. And I want you to take your right pointer finger and place it right in the palm of your hand, right around your wrist. Now what we're gonna do is slide the pointer finger up the thumb. And as we do, take an inhale through the nose and then slide back down with an exhale. Slide up the pointer finger, inhale. And then back down, exhale through the mouth. Slide up the middle finger, inhale. Back down, exhale. Ring finger, inhale. Back down. And then pinky finger. And back down. All right, so that's Take Five. If you were feeling really ambitious and you had a ton of time on your hands, you could do Take 10, and you do it on the other side as well. You know, this is a simple strategy that you can utilize really at any point throughout the day when you first wake up, while you're at work, while you're in the bathroom, before you go to bed. It really doesn't take that much longer than 30 seconds. And there's something about the tactile nature of this, of sliding the finger up, feeling the sensations of the hand, and then syncing that with the breath, that really does seem to engage the parasympathetic nervous system and help settle us in.
I'm not sure if that was a little choppy. I apologize if it was. Again, if you weren't able to do that, I will be sending everybody an email with some resources and also the links to those videos. It's called Take Five. So what I'm showing you here as well is some great apps. All of these are free. These are things that are great for introductions. So personalized meditations, conscious health, 7-second meditation. A really good one that I forgot to put on here, and I apologize, is Insight Timer. And that will be on your resource handout that I will get out to everyone as well. Insight Timer. And the reason I like that one a lot is because it's free. You can really pick the duration. And for me, you know, sometimes 2 minutes, it's perfect. And it, you know, doing a body scan, whether it's right before bed, it's just a great way to, you know, check in with myself and try to get my brain from worrying. Okay. So last and finally, I just want to wrap up just talking about a couple of resources. You know, how to get help right now at in Windsor-Essex County. The Crisis and Mental Wellness Center is still open. They are, however, encouraging absolutely everyone, please call first. The walk-in is still open, but they're encouraging that, you know, please call prior. Every single phone call is answered first by a crisis worker. So what you're getting when you are calling 519-973-4435, you will have a crisis worker and they're going to ask you, you know, and be honest. You know, sometimes guess what? You don't know this person on the other line. You don't even need to tell them anything. You can just go right into it. This is what I'm feeling. This is, I need help. I don't know where to access this, or, you know, I need help with, you know, looking into supports through CMHA or family services or houses offers. It doesn't matter what support you're looking for. The one number that I really strongly encourage everybody start with, and that is the Crisis and Mental Wellness Center. They are open again from 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. But again, I really want to encourage and stress that please call first. Another great online resource, and this is free to every single Ontarian, and that is Bounce Back. Bounce Back is a skill building program. It really, the foundation of Bounce Back is cognitive behavioral therapy for individuals who are currently experiencing mild to moderate feelings of anxiety or depression. It's a 1-800 number. Please, I will have this link on Monday for you as well. Don't forget, this is completely free. It is monitored 24 hours and you will get a coach attached and you would do everything either via online or they would mail you out your workbooks offered in, they keep upping the various languages. Please don't quote me or get, you know, I feel like they said there is more than 100 right now of languages that this Bounce Back is actually available in. If you want to check it out, simply go to bounceback.ca. I promise you, you'll get right there. And they do have, if you'd like to get started right away, they have one that you don't have to sign up or anything, and you just start watching the skill building videos right away. If you do want to have that personal one-on-one coaching sessions, then I really strongly encourage call your family physician to ask for a referral or call the toll-free 1-800 number. Another great, fabulous resource that I've heard nothing but wonderful things is Big White Wall. So bigwhitewall.ca, another thing that is free to anyone. And I apologize, Bounce Back is 15 plus. So if you even have a child, a youth, 15 years old, they're struggling right now with anxiety, stress, depression, you know, have them look up Big White Wall. Sorry, not Big White Wall. bounceback.ca. Big White Wall are for 16 plus. So if you have a youth, 16 years old, a young adult, you know, they're able to join Big White Wall. And Big White Wall is an online mental health platform. So it's very much peer driven. It is monitored through the OTN. It is completely monitored through trained psychologists, therapists. So it's 100% safe, what's really interesting and neat about the wall is that you join chat groups, you build a little community of support, you can take courses, you can creatively draw on bricks. It's just a myriad of things. It is fabulous. I've heard nothing but wonderful things. So those two things are absolutely free and you can get them instantly just by clicking and reading more about those. Okay, and last but not least, our community resources. Again, so how you access the CMHA, any CMHA services, everything is getting through the 519-973-4435 number right now. And a really great tool that I usually tell individuals to constantly look up is Kids Help Phone. I should have had it on here. I don't know how I stop my screen, but I don't know. So I'm just going to continue. I apologize. So another great website. Sorry. I was trying to think. What did I say? Kids Help Phone. Phenomenal. CAMH, I will also include that in an email on Monday. They have a website that the very first page, everything to do with managing our mental health, stress, anxiety during these times right now when we're all together, all experiencing a lot of change. And this is definitely a new normal that we're adapting. We're adjusting to. And you know, the one thing that sometimes gets me every day that it lowers my stress, it lowers those worrying thoughts, is I honestly can't say there's been a time in my life where I felt as connected to my community, my country. I've never collectively experienced or felt an emotion along the lines where we're all feeling it together. I have so much more in common with every single person that I did 2 weeks ago. So, you know, I know it sounds silly, but, you know, go on Facebook, look at, you know, scroll and check out friends that you haven't reached out, connected in like ages. Maybe it's a friend from kindergarten, you know, and just, hey, how are you doing? Are you safe? Are you okay? It's checking in on each other. That is how we help ourselves. That's how we can help others as well. And you know, it's through that social connection and keeping strong together and not keeping strong, let's say increasing that courage, right? Because that's how we are, we're working and looking at things. So thank you so much. I usually ramble on. I meant to stop way earlier. So if anybody has any questions, I know I don't have a lot of time, but I can totally answer any questions. You can unmute yourself and ask me a question, or if you'd like, you can send in a chat. I'm open for that as well. If not, I have no idea how. I don't know what I did. I lost my screen. Ha! I apologize, everyone. I lost my screen. I don't know what you're seeing right now. But if you are not seeing anything but myself, because last one I did, I guess it was my full face. If you're not seeing anything but my face, guess what? I will give you all of those resources, all those links. I'll send that in an email on Monday. And, you know, take care. Thank you for listening in. I mean, honestly, this helps me. Just talking it out. And I think that we're in this all together and we can talk it out together. Just spending an hour together, just telling ourselves, hey, it's okay that we're all feeling kind of up to here right now. It's okay to feel that way. We're in this together and we're just taking it day by day. So again, thank you for tuning in and keep safe, stay well, and that's it. Thank you.